Okay, so I think we'll start for this afternoon. My name is Monica Fundin-Pourshahidi, and I work here at the Swedish Museum of Architecture. And you're all very most welcome here today. The Swedish Museum of Architecture is a museum, of course, but we're also a national authority, and we have the government's assignment to increase knowledge and interest on architecture and design and the role that they play in society as a whole. So not least for that meaning, it's really interesting today to have the subject of today, can we preserve the heritage and face the needs of the future? Because what we're interested in is exactly what I said, what role do architecture actually play in society as a whole? And we also have an assignment to be a meeting point and to be a platform for debate. So perhaps you noticed that we also have another seminar here today. Just good for you to know that we also have another seminar in the other hall, and it's called Room for Death. It's on art and design in hospice environment. So if you meet other people here, a little bit lost perhaps, then you know why. But now, let's start for this day and this afternoon. And we're very, very happy to have this collaboration between us, the Museum of Architecture, and the City of Stockholm, the Stockholm City Museum, of course, and the Royal Institute of Technology, and of course, l'Institut Français. So very, very welcome. And I will now give the floor to Martin Rørby. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And my role here today is to try to be the moderator of this seminar. I'm an architectural historian, and I'm also secretary general and director for something called the Council for Protection of Ecological and Aesthetic Matters here in the City of Stockholm. And that is an advisory board that actually deals with cityscape and new buildings, new development in connection with our built heritage. So it's I do this every day, what we are talking about today on this seminar. We've already heard that the topic for this seminar is can we preserve the heritage and face the needs of the future? And as I said, this is something many of us have reasons to reflect on in our everyday work. As I'm sure you all know by now, the special occasion for this seminar is the 50th anniversary of the French Malraux law that made it possible not only to protect separate buildings and monuments, but also complete sites. It will be very interesting to learn more about this legislation and the similarities and differences between France and Sweden when it comes to how we handle our built heritage in connection with the strong demands for development and change that we face today. The seminar consists of two parts. First, we will have the pleasure of listening to three keynote speakers. Second, we will have a panel discussion where we have the opportunity to listen to reflections from three other guests apart from the keynote speakers. And at the end of the panel discussion, we will also have time to take questions from the audience. But first, I would like to give the word to Denis Villard, who is Councillor for Cultural Affairs and Cooperation and also head of the French Institut here in Stockholm. The floor is yours.
Right. Ladies and gentlemen, dear friends, colleagues, thank you for coming for this conference, which has been organized by maybe less or more people than you mentioned, I'm sorry. But in my mind, it was Institut Français, the School of Architecture, the Museum of Architecture, and of course, Stadtmuseet. And this conference was, of course, organized to celebrate this 50th anniversary of the Loi Malraux. I will say just a few words about it. First of all, I would like to mention a few things about Malraux. Of course, you all know him, maybe not completely. I will not mention the writer, not mention the hero of the resistance and the hero of the war in Spain. I will just mention the man who has been positioned by Charles de Gaulle as Minister for Culture at the first Ministry of Culture in the history of the Republic. And the success of Malraux was certainly undoubtful, as far as many governments after him took the decision to handle with such an administration for culture. Malraux defined the ministry's mission in few words. For him, the ministry had to take culture as close as people and to increase the audience as much as possible for the people who wanted to be close to culture. His aim was precisely to enforce the imagination, the creativity of the artist, and to help for the professionalism of the artist. And one of his main objectives was also to ensure the widest possible audience to heritage. And I think he greatly succeeded in this commitment, as far as in a period of a few years, he covered the country, the French country, with about 1,000 new museum, 1,200 new museums, 3,000 public libraries, and in a few years, and about 43,000 monuments were protected, thanks to his action and his impulsion. And of course, Malraux's most well-known initiative was this law, which bears his name, the Loi Malraux, which passed on the 4th of August 1962, 50 years ago almost, and which allowed to define a certain number of zones or areas to be protected, which forbid the construction or the erection of new buildings, but which allow mainly the owners of properties, historical old houses and so on, to be rehabilitated, and in putting the deficit of the restoration in their incomes without limit of the amount. And thanks to this law, many areas in France were saved, Sarlat, Saint-Germain-en-Laye, the old Lyon, and of course, the old Paris, Le Marais. You certainly have heard about the project of Le Corbusier, which intended to erase Le Marais, instead to build big towers, to open wide avenues. And thanks to the law, the massacre was stopped. And you may be sensitive to this event. As far as Sweden was involved in that time in purchasing one of the nicest mansions in Le Marais, whose name is Hotel Marle, to host the Swedish Institute. I met in October Michael Jonsson, the former director of the Institute. And it was 2 or 3 days after the Heritage Day, which in France allows people, the audience, to come in any administrative historical houses, the palace of the president, some libraries, some hôtel particulier. And he told me that it was not possible for him to reach his flat in the hotel, simply because there were too many people to visit the Hotel Marle, 300,000 in one day. And I must say that l'Institut suédois in Paris, is certainly one of the most well-known and a focal point, yes, thank you, the most well-known and the focal point of social and cultural Paris. Everybody is going to Hotel Marne in Paris. The other thing, which certainly is sensitive to the Swedish, regarding the Loi Malraux, is the fact that you had the same or similar project with Le Corbusier in Gamla Stan, which was saved thanks to the interventions of civil organizations and prominent personalities, concerned personalities. Thanks to them, there the project has been stopped. I would say that this conference is certainly pertinent then, as you say, and maybe timely because I have in mind the project of Susan. It certainly will be an object of discussion later on. And I think that it's certainly a good conference in this time of the period of the celebration of the Malraux Law. I wish to thank, in particular, Jesus Espeita from the School of Architecture, and Charlotte from Stadtmuseet, Lena Raoult, who is not there, and a special thought to Jean-François Cabestan from the University of Panthéon-Sorbonne, and also member of the Commission of Old Paris. I wish you a good afternoon and not so heat.
Thank you very much. Thank you. And now we will go to the first little lecture, and that will be by Johan Mortelius. And Johan Mortelius is professor in architecture history. He is research leader in architectural heritage and restoration at the Royal Technical Institute here in Stockholm. And you will talk about what Denis talked about just for one moment ago, the preservation of the old town in Stockholm. Welcome. The floor is yours.
So, yes, nice to see this crowd of people from these various institutions and connections, and to discuss some aspects about the preservation of the old town of Stockholm, which may seem to be now such an important part of the historic city that one would wonder, was it ever questioned to preserve? Yes, it certainly was, as we already heard about one such case. But let's go back to the mid-19th century, when the general image of the old town of Stockholm can be illustrated by these two images. It was considered to be an area of darkness, dirt, social degradation, and various criminality problems, etc. So a general idea was that something needed to be done. This part of the town needed to be cleared up, to be the focus of urbanistic intervention, just as well as the other parts of Stockholm. And ideas were proposed in this direction, where an important ideal plan was produced in 1862, where we see only one part of the old town preserved. This is the western part that was planned in the 17th century with its regular grid plan. This was the plan that was proposed to be continued into a kind of chessboard pattern with widened street, etc. Nothing left of the old structure of the old town, only a few monuments to be left. Well, this may seem now far from being realistic. It was not approved by everyone, but generally the idea was that something of this sort needed to be done with Stockholm. Not only the plans of the southern and northern parts, but even the old town needed to be treated somewhere like this. One of the references, by the way, was expectedly perhaps the planning that was going on in Paris by Napoleon III and Baron Haussmann, although not so much specifically referring to the old town as to the other parts of Stockholm. So this was the general idea of reformation of the old town around the area of the mid-19th century. However, not everything was about just modernization, renewing. Even the preservationists that would focus on the medieval architecture, the medieval history of Stockholm, could come up with proposals like this one. The very sensitive historian and culturally oriented person, Nils Månsson Mandelgren, presented one idea where the old town would be Gothicized. After all, very few medieval buildings existed. So a restoration or a conservation could mean actually medievalizing the city, but then also introducing urban space on a wide scale, as he had seen, for instance, in German medieval cities. Other proposals also for more radical plans of the whole city were made, such as this one in the 1870s, where we see a slightly more sensitive version of what you just saw here. Again, the 17th century plan is preserved and basically continued into the western part, whereas the eastern part somehow reflects the direction of Skeppsbrunn and also some more monumental buildings are preserved in this city. For instance, the Tessin Palace opposite the Royal Palace is proposed to be more or less preserved, which it was not in the plan that we just saw. So the debate was very much not against the plan as such, but against some individual buildings that were threatened by the plan. But still, the general idea was that something radical had to be done. If we move forward to the 1890s, we may see these two official plans, also by the engineering capacities of the municipality, proposing versions where the old pattern are a little more sensitively approached, but still needed to demolish very large parts of the built structure, although renewing it in what could be considered a modernized version, or what was seen as a modernized version of the street pattern that was already there, but very far from the existing historical city, as you can see. Still, at this time, around the turn of the 20th century, architects were becoming more aware of the interests, not just in monumental buildings, but also in the general pattern of the old town. And one example that may symbolize this is what you see here. In the latest years of the 19th century, two buildings next to each other along Skeppsbrunn were demolished. One was the palace that you see on the left, that was designed and built by Nicodemus Cassin the Elder in the mid-17th century, possibly for his own, as a palace of his own. This and the neighboring building forming the end of one block facing Skeppsbrunn were demolished in order to make way for a new building housing a new insurance company. An architectural competition was raised, but in the end it turned out that an alternative proposal was made by the architect who could be said to be the ideologically leading among architects of Stockholm. This was Isaac Gustav Claesson, who made a kind of restoration that we see here. Measured drawings have been made by young architects before the demolition of the building. This is why we have this drawing. And parts of it, as you can see, the central section with a classical colonized structure was reproduced as a center part of the new house, which was combining the central portal with the side portal, which was made possible because of the bending of the block, had been originally left some more space to protrude into the street. So he made this combination of these two, more three-dimensional, in other words, and composed the rest of the building in accordance with that. So this is reconstruction and a renovation, sensitively approaching the architecture of Ticino the Elder, but enlarging it to fit with the needs of the new structure. So it was trying to be both conservative and reformist at the same time. And this was an attitude that could be applied to the old town, not only individual buildings, but through individual buildings also. Instead of radically reforming the whole pattern, making minor reforms to individual buildings, sensitively listening to what was already there, and in this way achieving what was needed out of modernization. This was completed in 1901, the year that the Society of Saint Eric, the patron saint of Stockholm, the society that was formed in order very much to preserve the old town, and the houses were documented, and this was one of the major strategies in the preservationist movement of the old town. And Isaac Gustav Claesson was not only the leading architect, he was also one of the founding members of this society that is still quite active. So this is the result: renewal by sensitively, in part copying, in other parts echoing the old built structure. And we might say that today maybe this building of around 1900 forms one of the somehow defining buildings of the structure of Skeppsbron and the view of the old town. So the connection of individual buildings and the street pattern and the totality of the old town was somehow sensitively approached. And the reason why none of these plans that I had shown you had been realized, had been implemented, was as much about economic and practical reasons as, at least in the early part, as because of the resistance. But now the resistance movement was growing, and the next major planning intervention came about in the early 1920s, an architectural competition that was won by the son of Isaac Gustav Claesson, Gustav Claesson, and his colleague Walter Gahn. And their plan of 1923 is what you see here, more or less preserving what was there with some minor modifications. So instead of a general plan creating the problems of some individual buildings not fitting in the plan, making individual differences that would somehow affect the whole plan and adding to the whole plan. This is the time when the profession of architects is becoming more sensitive to the role of architectural intervention in the planning, the scales of architecture, the intimate scale of interior design, the scale of the building and the city, that these belong together, they are interacting, not believing in the engineering art of making a city plan as something coming from a different scale. These two architects also won the competition for the Royal Chancellery House on, you know where it is, on the northern edge of the old city. This was somewhat controversial, but reusing, for instance, the neoclassical portico of the Royal Mint that had been formerly there. However, the competition for the Royal Chancellery has been, in the architectural circles, more recognized because of the second prize winner, who was the famous Gunnar Asplund, along with his colleague Tudor Rydberg. So their entry of 1921 was this one, which perhaps more interestingly than Claussen's and Gahn's proposal reflects the urban texture, the urban fabric of the old town, somehow echoing the narrow blocks forming a main part of the old town and making them the basic structure of this institutional for the Royal Chancellery. However, this, as we know, was not implemented. But I like to show it as an attitude where the individual buildings reflect the understanding of the cityscape. Other interventions reflecting the sensitive approach to the individual buildings in its context can be pointed at, such as this major housing block facing the Stortorget, the main square, where the society I just mentioned, St. Eric, achieved the whole block and could make reforms by demolishing parts of the interior structure so that the aspect that was still considered important, problematic, the darkness, etc., was approached by giving more light, etc., to the structure. So preservation could be combined with reforming some of the problematic aspects of the old town. Finally, in the 1940s, we may remember this structure. We are now at the annex of the Royal Chancellery. The architect here is Otto von Schmalensee. He proposed and was implemented a design that radically reformed the interior, again, of the block, whereas leaving most of the, not all, but most of the exterior the way it was, but with some renewals. This was controversial. It was, in fact, considered by some to be demolishing, radically demolishing, very problematic. There were strong arguments against it, but there were also strong arguments in favor of it. But there were also, thirdly, arguments that consider this to be pastiche architecture. So somewhere in between preservation, radical reform, and negatively copying what was there before, this is the attitudes that was approached, that this was facing this project, so interestingly describing perhaps some problems. Finally, when I had the request to say some words here, the key word was Le Corbusier's intervention. I was not quite sure how to combine the aspect of the preservation of the old town with Le Corbusier's project, but anyhow, I will just finally say two words about it. We just heard it mentioned. Yes, it was not a preservationist project, even though the Royal Palace was favored by Le Corbusier. He liked to be pictured in front of it. He also admired some traditional architecture of the Nordic countries. This is his visit at Skansen, along with the Prince Eugen of the royal family. But of course, his project is radically changing most of what was there before. However, one may just reflect on some other projects that Le Corbusier had produced just in the years before, 1933, when he did this project for Stockholm. For instance, for Alger, he sensitively sketched and admired the urban townscapes, the alleys organically formed in the old towns of Alger and in the desert villages, and made this one of the starting points for his Obus plan of Alger. But not only that, also his idea of the modular, of the scale and human relationship to space was inspired by these meetings. So why not? Why could he not also admire and sensitively reuse the formal townscape of the old town? Well, this remains to be answered. So this was some very short introduction and reflections on the preservation of the old town. Thank you.
Yes, this was very interesting, and I mean, this picture actually makes something happen in your head when you see it. Now I would like to introduce to you Jean-François Capstan. He is a senior lecturer in the School of Architecture of Versailles. Along with teaching of history, he is part of a team of specialists in rehabilitation of the buildings of the past. He organizes many study tours, particularly in Italy. Also senior lecturer at University of Paris 1. He concentrates his activities of teaching and research on the problems of interpretation and transmission of heritage buildings. He is associate architect in Atrapa agency, specialized in the intervention of ancient surroundings, and he is also regularly publishing articles for the magazine RMC Moniteur on conversation operations that mark the contemporary architectural actuality. Please, the floor is yours.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for coming. Thank you for being interested in what some French teacher and architects can say. I would like to thank immensely Institut Français for the kind invitation, and through Denis Villard, and also to all this Swedish public, because I'm overwhelmed, delighted to be here. It's my very first time here in Stockholm, and very pleased. Loi Malraux, yes, 50th anniversary. Not going to speak that much. It's been so well presented by Denis Villard not long ago. Since every capital in Europe, all cities, we have to face very interesting problems. And I wanted to, of course, we'll be speaking about Paris, but I like to be a bit far away from Paris in order to maybe then get into details. But I couldn't resist from giving you the fruit of an experience we had with students. Last week we were in L'Aquila. L'Aquila, the damaged city, città ferita, as they say, where they experienced an earthquake in 2009. And this is 3 years after. Because considering the problems we have, it's maybe good to drive some comparison with dramatic situations, like cities where the natural problems, this is Basilica Sante Collemaggio. And I would insist on this map, which is the Forbidden City, because the decision, political decision, was made just after the earthquake to forbid the access to the entire historic city center, which was a decision due to the fact all the buildings were quite destroyed. 3 years after, this is the state of L'Aquila, which is a fantastic, maybe not as famous as Perugia or Siena, but very, you can see from these palaces, it's all, of course, with it's been protected. It's inagibile. It's not possible to use them. So the decision was made, and I think this is a parable of what is happening in all our cities, is to transform the city center, its gated community. We will see later on to the use of whom, but to spread the population in 19th districts, which were built from scratch. Here is one of them, at Camarda, that's the name we visited. And this for the population which has been kicked out of the city because of the earthquake. And at this scale, I mean, the speculation that is possible to think about the city center is, at the moment I took this photograph, 3 years after, it's incredible to see this car still damaged. I think we should think over such problem at this scale and draw some comparison with the problems we're going to have and to face. Paris developments in by Le Corbusier. Of course, I couldn't resist because I was asked to do that. And well, when I'm asked to do some, I obey like a child, and I'm very happy to. This is another, you can see, of course, Paris with the outskirts, yeah, the great axis, and some plans made by the beauty of these sketches, these drawings. And I'm not a specialist of neither 28th century and Le Corbusier, and I wouldn't dream of drawing some conclusions from the sight of these beautiful, interesting documents, which were made at a time, I'm speaking about the 20s, at a time where the horror for historic centers in all Europe was very much spread. So I will be admiring these wonderful sketchings. This, you can see, Ile de la Cité on the foreground. This is the end of Ile Saint-Louis. You can see the Eiffel Tower, you can see Montmartre, and this district devoted to towers and concentration towers among maybe some green areas. This is wonderful. All these drawings are kept at the Fondation Le Corbusier, of course. This is extremely interesting, and very often I would like to make some comparison between the exact plans and the real situation. You can very easily here recognize Ile Saint-Louis. This is, in fact, the Boulevard Sébastopol, which exists. And above you can see the boulevard. This would be an enlargement on Rue Etienne Marcel. And I realize my house is about here at the moment. So maybe I prefer it has not been done well. But, well, many are the reasons why destruction of historic buildings have been made. And we shouldn't think that Le Corbusier is responsible for everything, because his interpretation about the city, this is the Louvre, you can see here, and then, of course, and Boulevard Sébastopol, yes. Well, when we think about the destructions carried on at the time of Baron Haussmann, I think this interesting comparison between the medieval Lotswell, which find their the original states through the Middle Age period, and then transformed till the 19th century, and a proposal at the same scale by Le Corbusier. Well, that's interesting. So the idea was to talk about preserved areas in cities, in the modern cities. And of course, Paris' situation is quite interesting. Here on the map, you can see two of these secteurs of Gardé, which is Le Marais, on one hand, and here the 7th district. Why these areas rather than others? Because you may know that there are lots of interesting districts in Paris, the 2nd, the 1st, the 5th, very interesting, the 6th as well. So it's due because here you've got all the ministry of the embassies, and here the activity of association I belong to, Paris Historique, and Festival du Marais, which in the years just after the Loi Malraux organized many, many events in the courts, little concerts and conferences, and so that it was created. But of course, the whole city center is quite interesting in Paris, apart from these two secteurs of Gardé. So this is Le Marais from above. You can see some urban events, like a transformation, of course, of here, Ile de la Cité, at the time of Baron Haussmann, but also, more recently, such as Centre Georges Pompidou, at the time when some decisions, important decisions, and were taken in the centre of Paris. This is what I can see from my abusive terrace I had made in my home in Paris. And I enjoy enormously that viewpoint. But not everyone in Paris does. And this is the center of, again, recognize very important buildings, the Archives Nationales, the large quadrangle you have this here. And so the way the instruments which were created to deal with the situation, the restoring the building and ensuring development and preservation of this district. So it's an area. It's not gated, of course, but you have the limits. There is no precise reason why you shouldn't include more. But it was made. And then this is the Marais. This is based now, because it's been made in many, many cities. Denivia evoked the case of Saint-Germain-en-Laye, of course, but to show it's very spread all over the territory, French territory. And it's quite interesting to see the way it's done. The idea there is a hierarchy between the buildings based on criteria which now is a bit old-fashioned, which to such a point that we have to have a revision of this plan, which is painted in black, are historic things that should not be touched at all. Then you have the gray stuff, normal stuff, well, it belongs to the district. Then you have the orange could be improved, possibility of improvement. In yellow, things that should be destroyed. So, since this was made in the beginning of the 60s, all buildings dating for after French Revolution were to be destroyed. You see, so of course it's quite amusing. It's a lack of historical judgment on things. It's most peculiar. And since the creation of Le Marais, I mean the most famous buildings like Hotel Carnavalet, Hotel Salé, all these buildings are dating back to the 17th century. So there's the idea, very much anchored in a spirit of history, of a monument history in France, that the buildings should be turned back to the state they were supposed to be in the 17th century. And if there is an enlargement, a gallery of the 18th century, we should destroy it. And separate elevation of the building, this should be disappear as well. And we have lots of examples, and I will give you examples of this reality. So this is detailed, you can see, because if you know the district very well, it amused me, it was yesterday evening, to make comparison with the situation and to register the fact that some buildings have been really destroyed. If there was a Villa Savoie by Le Corbusier in the Marais, I would be frightened by the destiny of this building. Well, this is important also to know to which we refer, as far as methodologiquement parlant, methodologically speaking. to what we refer, because in fact our knowledge and history and architecture is all linked with books which were printed and written in Italy, which in a way were translated in books we are famous in France, of course maybe not here. And all the teams with François Boudon, André Chastel, which are people, unfortunately André Chastel is dead now, but François Boudon, François Hamon are still alive, and I know them. And the investigation that they did on Paris are very, very interesting. A group of professors in Versailles, Jean Castex, Philippe Panhey, reflected on the urbanization of Versailles at the beginning, throughout the centuries, considering every epoch as its interest. I did myself a book on Paris at a time when I couldn't resist. A very interesting point under the reign of Louis XV, at a time when instead of living in vertically, I mean to have different rooms and then to get upstairs to get the bedroom and then servants upstairs. The idea to have flats, subpurposed flats, in order to ensure the process of density. Urban references, because when we speak about the restoration, to which city do we refer? Where at the time, in the 20s, here in Stockholm, what is exactly the example? Which city? Because we know all these examples, the ideal city of the Renaissance, La Cité de Chaux by Ledoux. These other plans by, of course, you know whom, in Berlin, a bit before Second World War. This by Helm Kolas with a collection of, I couldn't resist in putting this, because, in a way, our city centers, with historic buildings, turn out, in the spirit of who are carrying the restoration of them, in a collection of different buildings, the most beautiful, and then maybe destruction of the what is between. That's very important to understand, because now we turn back. This is a city, not the present, there is no present. The state of Ile de la Cité in the 18th century. You can recognize Notre Dame, you can recognize the Palais de Justice, you can recognize Sainte-Chapelle, hasn't changed much. Here, Place Dauphine, part is lacking, but more or less. This is the only remaining buildings, some streets, but the majority has disappeared. You can't recognize the bridges, because what is extremely interesting is that this period, till the reign of Louis XV, you could cross the river Seine to go from the south bank to the right bank without knowing you were crossing a bridge, the river, because you had no sight at all. So this is an extremely different city. And when we refer to 18th century, I'm a specialist of the 18th century, so I'm supposed to be very conservative, conversationist, and so on. But in fact, this city, I don't think nobody, no one would dream of turning back to this situation. At a time when the largest street in La Cité was Rue Neuve Notre Dame for royal processions coming from there. Can you imagine the court, Marie Antoinette, there? Which kind of carriage? It was very inconvenient, you see. So, in effect, one has to. This is wonderful examples. You showed them for Stockholm as well. These are photographs by Marville. The city center. At the time, well, in my little passage I live, near Rue Saint-Denis, Passage de la Trinité, well, it's about, I can touch the walls like this. But the only one remaining in Paris, all this has totally disappeared. These are wonderful photographs. And so, I'm going to show you some examples of historical buildings to show how different they were. You can recognize Hotel Sully, Rue Saint-Antoine, the state it is now, which refers to the original state at the time Loi Malraux was done, which was totally different. And you can see that, of course, the transformation of the building, but also the social transformation it refers to. There were shops, there were hundreds of families all spread in the building, and now you have a museum where Caisse Nationale des Monuments Historiques. And you see the object has been totally purified due to, orientated by the knowledge we could find about old buildings. So I have just a few examples of this way. Maybe you know the rear facade of Musée Picasso. That's a bit strange. There is a fence, an iron fence, iron work. There is a private garden. There is a public private garden where the visitors of Musée Picasso can go. And then this is a public garden. But when you have a look into the documentation, then you see this, a bit before Loi Malraux, at a time when all these aristocratical houses had been transformed, converted to the use of craftsmen and lots of warehouses in the gardens. But, well, this is the state it was transformed to. And at a time, you just wonder, is it an improvement? Is it a real improvement or not? The stratification, the historical peers, I mean, the history of Hotel Salé from totally disappears in an image which tends to transform the Hotel Salé in an engraving as you find in the theoretical treatise of architecture. This, for example, the Museum of Musée d'Histoire, d'Art et d'Histoire du Judaïsme. There's an enormous falsification. I know that because I was. We were going in Le Marais with my family. That was the beginning of the 60s. I was very young at that age, and my grandfather. Look, these buildings. They will be transformed. They will be turned to museum. And what I saw at that epoch was that. You see. Of course, you can recognize part of the 78th architecture, but you see, of course, the use. This was a shop, there were craftsmen, it was a Jewish district, of course. And then it has been, you can see three stories more, and then wings, I mean, all the population. And you see, with the interest we have for the historical thickness, depth, profondeur, depth, yes, depth of building. One who is accustomed to considering Italian monuments such as Castel Sant'Angelo, which you perfectly know, it's Roman tomb, and then it's been transformed to a fortress, and then to a papal villa, and then to a museum, and all this is visible. In the end, when you compare the two states, you realize what you see in Le Marais, in the end, is totally fake, because it's totally been constructed, it's nothing to do. Of course, you have part of it. The upper decoration, the balustrade, and all this in the end, the roof and the chimney pieces above. But what's this? That's, in the end, it's true that in Le Marais, you have a very strange collage stuck together. These pieces that are original because there were no aristocratical hotel or mansion, and then the normal stuff. But even the normal stuff, the so-called minor, this is derived from Italian terminology, where they would be speaking about edilizia minore, minore, so-called, because, well, I think it's quite important and interesting. This is not in Paris, but I've been very much amused. That was once in Potsdam. Near Berlin, where you can see these timber frame structures. So, what is amusing is that, well, this is original timber frame structure. These houses were made this way, with beams, with wood. And, of course, it was covered with an internaco. And here, this is, of course, what they call in Germany, ein Witz. This is a joke, to make see, well, we're not that stupid. We know that we're composing, this is for tourists. But in France, now, in Paris, this is Rue François Miron. And I normally put the original state on the left and then the present state on the right. But I thought it was amusing to mix things in order, well, what's the original in the end? Because, well, this is the present state of these houses. This before Loi André Malraux. And this was a temptation at the time to make see the structure of buildings, to make them appear older than they actually are. And so in the large amount of streets in Paris, they have transformed to a very far extent and to make them look like in a Disneyland in order to make people think it's historical state because there is some wood. And it was written in certain stupid guidebooks that these two houses were the oldest in Paris, due to the fact that there's no idea that till the reign of Henry IV, which is the beginning of the 17th century, all the houses in Paris were made of wood, which would disappear under the plaster, because in order to avoid fires, like the fires in London, you have a series of rules in Paris which insists no piece of wood should ever appear. And this caused the destruction of lots of buildings, because this is more difficult, of course, to preserve these from the rains, from the water, from such elements. And and as far as isolation is concerned, you can imagine the difficulty of isolating the part under the roof in the new state. And so we have to think, all this architecture in Paris is not what it looks like, because behind this stone facade, in fact, the architecture in Paris is all made of wood. The carpenter does a lot, an awful lot. All the plancher, the stories, the floors, of course, all the staircases, and of course all the roof. It's just the facade. And then, even here, the rear facade, it seems it's the thickness makes things it's stone, but very often it's timber frame structure as well. So, well, the more you know about this architecture, the more you know about the detail, all the economy based on the fact you have fireplaces and then conducts for the smoke, and it's very complicated, and it's in all parts of the way it's done. And then, from another point of view, history of art, the moldering. This is driven from Blondel. You see these moulderings, and the idea of making drawing a comparison between the profile, human profile, and the profile of a cornice. And we all know that in very good architecture, like the one of Gabriel, the different facades of Trianon are due to the effect of the light, whether it's light from above because it's south, or light horizontal because it's the west. And of course, it's this graduation into the drawing of the facade. You have pilaster or columns, and it's an effect. You have four different facades, and the four, I should have make you seem interested to show you the four facades, which are totally different, of course, due to the lighting. But what we sometimes do not know is that for just very simple facades, like this in Paris, I found in the archives such documents, this is about nearly as big as here, with the detailing of every profile. This is written exactly the size, the shape. And so when you say this is, well, just average house, edilizia minore, in fact, it's very complicated. And I was very surprised to see these are the profiles, scale one, of the different horizontal, which are all of them different because they're adapted to the relative obscurity in a very narrow streets there were in Paris. So when they say we will rebuild the way it was, come era una volta, as they say in Italian, identical, what we say in French, you know that on no count, because nobody knew about this. So how can you manage to think that you're able, to, even for a very simple facade? As far as tooth cutting is concerned, when you have such drawing, for very simple, but which refers to a technical approach of a cutting stone dust, we have no idea of. For example, who noticed that here, on this very beautiful building at the angle of Rue de Bretagne et Rue Vieille du Temple, that the stone cutting here is very, 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 very peculiar, because they wanted to have horizontal joints, vertical joints instead, like this, which means that it's in the depth of the masonry that each of these stones will then converge to a central point, which is what we call plate-bande en fausse coupe in French, which you find at the portal of churches, when you find for very subtle buildings, because you want to make find a comparison with this plate-bande and the Doric frieze, because method and triglyphs are perpendicular. So, and this building offers 51 windows and doors, and 51 times you have this detail. So, well, the more you know about, then here you have this, then the more you think that it's impossible to have them rebuilt. The problem of facadism. In all Europe, we know that. The fact of just keeping the facade, destroying all the inside. And of course, if some of people think French architecture might be interesting, it's not precisely because of the facade. No, we were never very good at facades. We have to go to Italy, other people. I saw wonderful facades here in Stockholm, but France is not peculiarly interesting for facades. I don't think so. No, no. What is interesting, which I studied a lot, is inside distribution. The art of distributing the places, the galleries, the halls, the drawer, music rooms, bedrooms, cabinet, little things, that's very, but this, all this disappears because it's behind, and so nobody will ever know about that. Well, it happens very often, and André Marais was very much against that, is this is not facadism, this is pastiche. Because the in France, the people who decide, I mean, the intelligentsia, or all the people that normally you should know about architecture, know very little. And it's most extraordinary the fact that in France, when someone is very rich, very wealthy, he won't have a house built by a good architect. Never. He will have he will buy an old house, an old chateau. That's the way that we will do. No interest at all for architecture, the idea that all architecture is all right is quite spread in modern architecture. It's very difficult to have some new buildings done in Paris, and Centre Georges Pompidou is a real exception. It's because it's always refused. The architects in Paris do not even dare. You have to be very famous to ensure the fact that maybe you could have something modern. All these houses, you don't realize maybe that this, it's all brand new. That one is very visible because it's axis in Rue Étienne Marcel. It's about the same. So the situation is very complicated. I wanted to, in the end, show you these wonderful documents at the Fondation Le Corbusier. I don't know if we didn't see them yet, and I think in order for the discussion, it might be very interesting. This is a large map with all the area. I think that's very interesting, the interest for Le Corbusier of whatever what one would think about the project itself, and consider the area of Stockholm at a very large scale, which is this, of course, as well. And then a last one, that one. This, I don't know whether you... Mm-hmm. Well. My idea was to talk... I don't know. Well, thank you for listening.
Thank you. And we shall present you also with this kind of goodie bag. Get back to this and the Slussen project maybe later on.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
And now I would like to present to you Arne Fredlund. He is an architect and also a senior advisor at Stockholm City Planning Administration, which is responsible for the planning of Stockholm both in large and small scale and as well as concerning building permits. And Arne will try to talk about what we all really, of course, also have in our minds, the challenge of the past and the future when we have a city developing very quickly. Please, Arne, the stage is yours.
Thank you, and I'm very happy to have been listening to what's been said so far. It's very interesting, and working as an architect and an urban planner in Stockholm for the city of Stockholm, we often look to other European cities for inspirations, and we very much more like to look to Paris, for example, than to London, if you compare what's going on in those two cities. So it's a lot of knowledge behind what you are telling me about, and it's very interesting. That makes me a little bit shy about what I'm going to say, because I'm intending to give you some reflection about challenges working for the city of Stockholm today, and it's more about raising questions than giving you answers. So. But anyhow, there are some challenges I would like to share with you. One is kind of trivial, and it's also something that you're proud of, that is very nice. And the first challenge to me is that Stockholm is a beautiful city, and a city with a historic heritage, a lot of things and districts to be proud of and to try to preserve. Why I say this is a challenge is because every time we try to make new additions, make changes to Stockholm, we find out that also a lot of people in Stockholm love the city. We have lots and lots of letters telling us this should not be done or this should be done in a different way. And it is, in a way, a challenge to work with the city that has a lot of values, I think. And I'm reminded of many, many years ago, I made a visit to Murmansk in the northern part of Russia, a city that was totally destroyed during the war and rebuilt in very few years, with blocks looking the same almost all over, and not a very inspiring city, I'd say. If someone is from Murmansk, I apologize for what I'm saying here, but I remember coming to Murmansk, I was presented with a tourist brochure, a folder, saying that Murmansk is the city that grows more and more beautiful every year. And of course, if you start from the point that Murmansk was, when I was looking at it, it wasn't so difficult to fulfill that objective, I think. In Stockholm, of course, we are very much criticized for a lot of changes that is taking place in sensitive areas. And at the same time, there is a political understanding that we have to be very much aware of what we are doing. Our mayor, Sten Nordin, I have often heard him repeat that it's not only about quantity. We have to build many new things in Stockholm, but it's also about quality. It has to be good. The result has to be very good, because otherwise the people in Stockholm would start to protest more, and we couldn't follow the strategy that we have to, he thinks, to develop Stockholm. So the new additions have to be very good, and that's part of the problem we have today. The second challenge I want to mention is that Stockholm is right now Stockholm is a very rapidly growing city. It grows more than it has in many, many years before, and of course there was also a lot of growth during the industrialization. But if you look, for example, at the expansion of Stockholm in the 50s, 60s, and 70s, a lot of that was also because of parts of Stockholm was demolished during those years, and a lot of apartments had to be replaced. Today, we don't demolish very much at all. Not when it comes to housing, anyway. And what's being built today is we have a challenge building a lot more new housing, a lot more new workplaces, more infrastructure, certainly, and also comes with that more museums, cultural institutions, more movie theaters, maybe, more services of different kinds. So there is a lot of things that has to be renewed or newly built in Stockholm. And part of that challenge is also that the strategy for the urban development of Stockholm today is not the same as in the 50s and 60s and 70s, because in those years, we had a strategy that we built one new suburb further and further out along subway lines and commuter train lines and expanding the size of Stockholm. The strategy today means it's intended to be a strategy much, much more inviting a sustainable way of thinking when it comes to both in the environment and climate changes, but also about the economy, for example. A strategy that means that we are building within the already existing structure, the urban structure that already exists, is redeveloped, not expanded. And that is a new situation. How do you add to something you like without destroying it, but at the same time adding to it in a way that it doesn't look ugly or too self... it has to look in a nice way. Sometimes I think that when you say Stockholm is a beautiful city, I'm a bit sad as well, because most of the things that are beautiful in Stockholm today is built many years ago. You don't find so much buildings or areas today that is newly built that you are really proud of? And I think we have to change that. If we have to develop Stockholm the way I'm saying, we have to add to the existing structure in a way which is very nice and that both people and experts will love. The really two difficult decisions we have to make about this strategy of redeveloping the already existing structure. One is about the inner city. The inner city of Stockholm has for a long time been very well defined, and now we have a policy of expanding the inner city beyond its previous borders on former industrial areas, harbor areas, railway freight yards, and areas that don't have so much use any longer and can be redeveloped for multi-purpose urban structure. And that means with the same kind of density, I think, as the already existing inner city, which means a radical change of what you will think in the future of being the inner city of Stockholm. How to do that? Should you add that as new areas, or should they look similar to what's already been built before? And in what grammar, so to speak, what scale, what pattern should you work with? That's one thing. If we are to develop Stockholm in the pace that we need, looking to the radical increase in population every year right now, we also have to look at the outer city. And the strategy for the outer city in Stockholm is to start connecting those individual districts, individual suburbs, building them together and increasing the density in some of them as well, while adding in some parts, in the focal points, in some points like Vällingby, Farsta, and other places surrounding Stockholm, we think that we have to build many thousands new apartments. How to do that in those areas? And how to connect those areas to each other? Because traditionally they are separated by green belts, by infrastructure, by institutions like schools, and how to connect them. And maybe you shouldn't connect all of them. Maybe you should connect some of them and make a decision about that. I'm not sure. As I say, I'm raising questions and not giving answers. The third challenge I'd like to share with you, and that's something I'm not so sure of, because I'm not an expert on that. I'm looking to Ann-Charlotte, for example. I'm checking what you will say. It's about the idea of historic heritage, of cultural values. In my view, not being an expert, this idea is sort of changing today compared to what it has been before. And we have a lot of new evaluations about the structure of Stockholm, the different districts, what historic value do they have in both buildings and areas. And one thing you can notice is if you look at the objects, the monuments, not so much, but buildings of different kinds, a lot of the buildings that are of historic value, according to what you say today, was defined for a very specific function, for a very specific use, and they don't function for that use any longer. How should you, can you transform them? That's often very difficult. If you look, movie theaters are one such kind of buildings, for example, and the movie industry is totally changed today. There is no use for old movie theaters. We have laboratories, fire stations, many other kinds of buildings that is very difficult to find new use for. What should you do with them? And that's one really difficult problem. Another problem, or problem, that's the wrong expression really, another change is that, and that's not so new, that's actually what we have been talking about some today, preserving districts and areas instead of monuments and objects. In Sweden, we changed the law in 1987, making it more possible than it was before to preserve areas or districts. Before that, the preservation was more oriented to individual buildings and monuments. Today, we see sort of the result of that change more and more. And also, when you discuss the preservation of districts and larger areas, it's not so much about demolishing or renewing, because demolishing is not an alternative. It's about how do you add to already existing areas in a way that listening to the architectural qualities of that area and listening to the character of that area, and in the same way really changing them radically, because that's what we often need to do. And also there is a new concept of, you could call it accumulated damage, I think, if you change areas in small steps, and each step is not so harmful, but the amount of the change could be harmful. That's also a difficult concept to discuss when it comes to individual proposals coming to my office, and we have to decide, should we allow that or not? Also about the idea of historic heritage, there's another issue as well. And that is kind of what I think, an increasing discrepancy in between expert evaluation of historic values and other people's evaluation. And it's very obvious to me, being a little bit older than I was many years ago, many of the buildings that are supposed to be of great value today, they were built when I was young. And of course, to me, I'm not always so fond of them as other people might be. And I think that reflects a change that is not individual for me, but it is also in our society, that the evaluation of historic quality and what should be preserved has come up to buildings and districts that are built quite newly in recent years. And many people doesn't share the idea of the value of those areas. And working for a political organization, of course, that's a big problem, because it's easy to preserve what people think should be preserved. It's very difficult to find support for preserving something that most people doesn't care so much about. I'm coming to kind of a conclusion about this, and I think it's about how to find a working strategy, balancing on one side the preservation, the need for preserve the beauty of Stockholm and the historic values, and also the radical need for changes that we have. We couldn't say no to that. I don't think so. There is not an alternative. In the late 20th century, our strategy was kind of working with very much listening to or echoing the already existing districts and trying to describe the characteristics of certain areas, what to be very careful about, and a kind of careful strategy coming to change. And a lot of buildings built, added to in those areas in the late 20th century, they look similar to what's already been built. They have the same kind of grammar, if it's the inner city with a very obvious bottom floor with the shops and then three, four stories of apartments and then a roof line that is very traditional. And sometimes if you don't look very careful, it's even hard to see if it's a new or an old building. I remember when this museum was designed and built, we were standing in the council, the board that makes the first level of decision about new planning in Stockholm. And we were so proud that we could show pictures that it won't be very much seen from Strandvägen, and you won't see it at all from the old town. And it's a marvelous new building, but no one will see it, otherwise they come here. And that was something we were proud of, because it wouldn't. The idea was making changes, but not so easy to notice the changes. Today we try to find, and that's really a challenge, to find a strategy to combine the knowledge about the past and what's the values of that with a strategy that invites more radical thinking in architecture, more trying to find new ways of dealing with the combination of old and new, and finding ways that can add to the quality, so we will be proud, very much proud, also of the new additions, that they will stand out, that they have an architecture that we can be proud of, that a strategy that demands, I think, for it takes a lot of skill to do that. I'm not certain we will manage, and if we fail, it will definitely not be very good for Stockholm. But if we could manage and could succeed with this strategy, it's really, I think, what Stockholm needs. But it takes, I think, more competition in between different thinking about architecture, more competition about different solutions, how to solve an architectural problem if you build in a sensitive area. And also a lot of discussion and debate, because you have to share the discussion with a lot of people, with the people living in Stockholm, with the experts on historic values, with experts on architecture. And we are trying to work with that as urban planners in Stockholm today through a document that we are right now trying to finalize. And that's a policy, Stockholm architecture, as an addition to the master plan of Stockholm. It should be an addition to that plan. And it is, the idea is to forward this policy, and in this policy forward more of architectural experimenting in Stockholm, but not in a way that destroys all that we already have, but tries to improve new solutions, new architecture, new thinking. And the true being working for the city, the true judge for what we are doing will certainly be the people living in Stockholm, because they are the most important. And as you hear, I don't have answers. It's only questions. And I'm sorry for that, but I'm happy to be here. Thank you.
That's actually very good, because I think we will, the important thing is that we really reflect upon these things. Here's the goodie bag for you too. Thank you very much. And now we, since the time is passing very quick, I think we should start at once really with this little panel discussion. And then I would like for you to, the previous keynote speakers, to please come up on the podium and sit down. And then we will also invite three more persons to come up on the stage. And that is Ann-Charlotte Backlund, it's Alexis Pontvik, and it's Erik Wingquist. And these three people will also give some brief reflections to start this panel discussion. And I would therefore like to introduce to you, as the first person of these three to give her brief reflections, Ann-Charlotte Backlund. She is an architectural historian at the University of Stockholm. She is the City Conservation Director and Director of the Stockholm City Museum since 2007. Previously, she has been working at the County Administrative Board in Stockholm as Director of Cultural Heritage Section. So please, Ann-Charlotte Backlund, some short reflections to start this panel discussion.
Okay. I just have to show you some pictures. And I must say, it's a bit difficult to come after Arne, as he has said quite a lot of what I was planning to say. So I make it very short. Well, as we already heard, much of the built environment of Stockholm is of cultural and historical value. And the Department of Cultural Heritage at the Stockholm City Museum, among other things, assesses the significance of the built environment and works to ensure the preservation and conservation. And the department is responsible for buildings of all periods throughout the entire city, not just this kind of old areas, as we've already seen. And this type of buildings. But also later periods. Even if the future will see a lot of new buildings as the city is growing fast, most of the built environment consists of houses already built. Although there are different ways of protecting the built heritage, the bulk of the cultural heritage matters are dealt with using the quite ordinary General Planning and Building Act. And for me, that represents a great possibility. And looking back, most buildings from before the 1950s are well kept, and the general understanding of the cultural value is high. But the challenge today is to recognize the younger heritage. All that have been built in the outskirts in the late 20th century, for instance. This was an example from Vällingby. This is a very ordinary type of housing that there are quite a lot of in different parts of Stockholm. And there's also a younger heritage in the center of Stockholm. And Anna said, how do you add to already existing structures? Well, I'm not sure that I have the answer. I really don't. But as Monsieur Capstan also said, all changes, both when building in a new area as well as in alterations in an old building, should be based on knowledge of the specific background and history of that area or building. And then you can make an active choice what qualities you want to keep or to change. And I'm actually quite convinced that we will have to change quite a lot. But we must also recognize that the local environment is important for the inhabitants and their identity. So every change must be done with really a very careful study. That was my introduction.
Thank you. Then I would like to ask Alexis Pontvik, architect, owner, Pontvik Architects, and professor of urban planning at the Royal Institute of Technology School of Architecture for some brief reflections.
If I understand the last two speakers right, the big worry is the turbae populorum, the people of the city, and perhaps not the buildings. I will share with you some more provocative. I hope you expected that. So, how do I get the full screen view here? Voila. Voila. Let me share some views with you. I've just selected them because I thought they were sort of acutely interesting. I think it's the word ensemble, which is a French word, is extremely interesting. What's this? Leave me in peace. And it's defined in as a group of separate things that contribute to a coordinated whole. I think it's quite a nice and wonderful sentence, and it's highly relevant. And I can think of many environments which were of excellence. And if I hear Ann-Charlotte Backlund, the last speaker, I get really worried, because everything can be changed somehow. Everything is possible to be changed. I don't think that way. I think if we have excellence, we keep excellence, and then we can do other things as well. This is the 1950s development of a high order. The tall buildings, the shopping street, all the bits and pieces which sum up a period. And I think it's a wonderful piece, and it's already being nagged on all over the place. Here is a near miss, one of the great landscape situations in the center of the city, with Aspen Library, with the Tengbom School, Economic School, and many other buildings, and a landscape which is created from the 17th century up to the 30s. An environment of great value. And this was nearly, this happened to it, leaving the Aspen Library alone at the corner, and the whole grand landscape spoiled. So we are always in a very dangerous situation, I tell you, in this city. And I think we should educate the public and the civil servants. And it's part of our responsibility. And let me now, I see some people from the National Property Board here, Fastighetsverket, and this is what I have to say to them. I can read in their homepage that our endeavor is to protect and preserve our heritage in the best possible way. Let's have a look at the next picture. This addition, rooftop addition, is built under the same institution, which claims to have a great sort of care for the city. It's behind the Royal Academy of Arts, it's next to the seat of government, and it's facing to the old town across. So what many people don't know, if you look at the map at the right corner over there, you see a red patch. it's a red patch, it might be rather insignificant, but it so happens that it covers the entire city of Stockholm. And in that area, these additions are in principle allowed. And I would like to all the Stockholmers to know this. I think people don't realize it, and bit by bit, we get new kind of roofs, which are making a new kind of roofscape to Stockholm. I think that another central question in dealing with old buildings, where we constantly fail in this country, we don't have these academic problems with facade restoring like the French. Our problems are much more basic and severe. This is a building which is coming up. I found it it's a bad picture, but I found it in a building magazine which was lying around in the office. And this is being built now. It shows the kind of greed which happens and the sort of pro forma renovation and the programmer is virtually squeezing up in the behind. And I think the question is somehow to ask buildings what they can take, to understand an existing structure and put yourself the question, how can we use it? Because it so happens that old buildings are useful structures, extremely useful structures, and they have a lot of potential, but the potential has to be read. And if you have a preconceived program of 20,000 square meters, which have to be squashed in a building, you are always off. You have to ask the building, take on, what is adequate, what is in principle feasible within the type of structure we're talking about. And this is just a temporary contemporary in LA, which at the short period replaced the mocha and actually the old factory is the much better museum of art, just to say that. Then there are major, we can also talk about landscape, I think, because we cannot, if you think about the city of Stockholm, I think the topography is very important as part of the total cityscape. It's not the waterways only, but also the topographic situations. And here you see the new additions by Norman Foster and Barry Architects, which are building outside the line of the big fault. Here you see the fault running along east-west direction, one of the primary topographical features of the city. And by building this, you open for the building of the whole. It's a precedent which will just be continuing. And I think generally showing the plan of Lucca, which I always like to look at, you see this fantastic mingling of different periods. You see the Roman plan in the Renaissance walls and some contemporary features. I think it's a great plan. And even the master said, history is the master. And I think it's very interesting. It's very interesting. You can criticize Corbusier on many ways, but I think he created a family of forms which we still are using, which contemporary architects are using. And he drew the power and the inspiration from historical precedent to these extreme modern projects he did. So history is the master. And of course, good examples. And if there is a city with good examples, there are Musée Guimet, Musée Picasso, Louvre, Histoire Naturelle, all these. I mean, there are 20 museums in old buildings which work very, very well. So that is what I had to say. I had a lot more to say, but I had to stop.
Thank you so much. And finally, then, as an introduction to this panel discussion, I think a lot of you are eager to discuss things with each other. But I would then like to present Erik Wingqvist, who is an architect, co-owner of a firm named Testbed Studio, and it's an architectural office that mostly work within public space. Please.
Thank you. I do not have any images, and I will try to be brief. And thank you all for your presentations, and thank you for inviting me. The whole topic, and I talked with Alexis on the bus, we had company to this place together, is so kind of open and broad, and I think there are many ways to talk about heritage and also way to talk about this overall topic. But two words that I found quite interesting and important are, one is the idea of place and context, and how important that becomes when you talk about heritage. But if I reverse the tape a little bit, a popular TV show in Sweden is called Antikrundan, where you talk about the heritage of different artifacts and objects, and they are valued by money, and that is a way to somehow perhaps grade things. I think it's quite fun to watch, and it's becoming a little bit of a viewer success, I would say, touring different cities and so on. If you compare the kind of heritage and quality in an object with the building, you realize the importance of the context. And what you can say now is that many things that happen and exist within the boundaries of Stockholm has a totally different, somehow, political and economical situation than if you look at other heritage, like the rural areas of Bergslagen, for instance, where we have a lot of beautiful industrial heritage buildings, but you do not have a density of people, or you do not have perhaps the same type of economy. So I think you need to really think very differently depending on where you are. And when Johan started to show all examples of Gamla Stan, that was more or less the whole city of Stockholm. I mean, the footprint of Stockholm in the 17th century was not so much more than the old town of today. And I also found that interesting in Monsieur Cabestan's lecture, how you could see the still central part, like Le Marais, which is a bigger and more dynamic place than Gamla Stan, which is so well-defined. You need to have perhaps a much more open aspect towards what do you protect and what not. And I think also objects like Centre Pompidou is also something that could really strengthen the old heritage, so to say. And so just to sum up what Arne talked about and also Ann-Charlotte, is that in Stockholm today, I would say that the old city is so well-defined and framed, and it's also such an important part of an economy. I mean, tourism being a very important part of contemporary economy as well, I would think. There's the interesting challenge in how do we look upon what is built now when Stockholm is expanding? Because during the post-war, Stockholm expanded in agricultural fields and empty natural spaces a lot, and now we have to expand on things that are already built. And I think it could be very important to think about structures from the 80s, 70s and 80s, and try to understand and have the same precision as many historians have about artifacts and objects from 300 years ago, to learn that. Because otherwise it's important to we could miss important things, I would say.
Yeah. Thank you so much, Erik Wingqvist. And there are a lot of things, of course, in the air now. And I, before I let you talk to each other, because that is what you should do, but I think I would just like to stress what you actually said right now, that we are also living in an era today when a building is already old, in a sense, when it's 20 or 30 years old. That means that we actually, I think, have to have some kind of at least idea whether this is a building that would be preservable or that we would like to preserve when it's 100 years old, because it might disappear when it's 20 years old. And that is what we have seen in the city of Stockholm the last decade, when very young buildings have disappeared, and some of them, well, they should disappear, but some of them might not have been destined for that, really. So that's a very important thing, I think. But I will not try to lead this discussion too much. I would rather say that I think you have comments on each other's perspectives. Does anyone want to start to comment on, or shall we invite our friends?
I thought it was rather interesting, yes. The discussion of bringing it outside the town as well, because I think there are a lot of agriculture structure in the whole of Europe which are standing and continuously being emptied, which have no use. And I think on that level, that is even more, because as you rightly said, the economy is another one, and the lack of closeness to economical center and magnets, these buildings just, and it's the same if it's the Alp, if it's the northern Sweden, it's all the same. And I think new ideas must come up how to deal with this, because it's happening all over. So I think it's interesting to talk about what you mentioned outside town.
Absolutely, and I mean, in Sweden we also had the problem that actually our churches is now being sold out and actually torn down, since we don't have this governmental support for the churches as we used to have. So that's one thing, and that's we're talking about not only 19th century churches but also medieval churches. So that is one aspect of it. Please.
Well, I think we have to keep very serene on the perspective of how to manage, how to cope with the development, the future of all these buildings. For example, in France, we know that we have about 100,000 churches that we do not know what we're going to do with, because because of religion, lack of religion, whatever the reasons might be. And I can remember, we'll give you a very precise example. When I was a kid, I would go to the marketplace. It was in the center of France that was named Loudun. And there was, the market was, they would sell fish and meat and cheese and vegetable in a Roman church. A part of the roof had been damaged, so there was an iron structure to replace part of the walls. And, well, it has been thought that this place should be restored and be transformed to a more prestigious use. And also it's been turned to a gallery. No more market, no more fish. And a gallery, and then the vault has been restored, and then no more this iron structure, you see. So, and I think this is a bit of a shame. I mean, it's linked with the organization, the tourism in France, which... I mean, the transformation of this back to a former city, which had been lost, I think this is a total misconception of the future to give to all these buildings. So I like very much your ideas about the idea to think about what is around, not only as far as geography is concerned, but also the social use of all these things, and so much important. And also what I think very interesting too, with the limit of the heritage you pointed out, is it 20 years ago? Because yesterday, once more, we had a debate at the Commission du Vieux Paris. Why is its name Commission du Vieux Paris? And I wanted to know Commission Saint-Éric. Well, Saint-Éric refers to old things, very probably, ancient and religious things. And we could think of renaming Commission du Nouveau Paris, maybe, in order to make sure, because we judge every now and then from building, should we destroy a building which is 10, 15 years old? And the discussion at times are very strong, and we do not agree at all. So it's many, many. I think from what I hear, the questions are very similar. I mean, either here in Stockholm or in Paris, I hear the same.
there is another. I think there is another interesting thing about Paris and Stockholm. If you talk about, say, city of continuity. I mean, often if you drive along Rue de Rivoli, or if you go around Paris, it's a sort of, it's grey. The roofs are similar. The materials is the same stone. Similarly to that, Stockholm has also clear continuity in its architecture. Although the colors vary, the main structure is of a kind. Mm. And I think that is, for the town planning office and for the city museum, a central question. To which degree, what does that continuity stand for? Which are its language and grammar and so on, as you mentioned? And is there, can we do a contemporary architecture introducing some of them, or does it have to be freaks somehow? And I'm not against freaks, but you have to have them. You have to have them at the right place somehow. And I think that's interesting. If you talk about urban continuity, right, which it exists very strongly in both cities, and we I would agree with you that previous decades they have been too tame, and they have been doing sort of 1920s architecture all along, and you can't see the difference. I think that's wrong too. Sorry.
I was thinking like cities like St. Petersburg, like Stockholm, Torino in Italy, where it's such a continuity, the concept of harmony, which has been criticized very much by André Corbeau, the French, you know, the Swiss author. For example, in Paris, you were speaking about the continuity of Rue de Rivoli, and that was 2 years, last year. There was a strong debate about the transformation of La Samaritaine by the famous Japanese team Sana. And, well, I defended the Japanese point of view of putting in, we will be all very surprised when it's done, really, because it's 100 meters facade like this, white, it's going to all glass and white, all the heights in Rue de Rivoli. So at a point where the Rue de Rivoli is not with the arcades behind the Hotel de Ville, where the Samaritan is. And I thought there, at times, it's a nightmare during the night, I think, oh, I was wrong, maybe. I do not know. But the idea that four Osmanian facades are going to be pulled down and taken away, and instead of this glass facade, I thought at times some elements, I mean, in Paris, you do not be anything apart from Centre Pompidou, which I like so much, really. That's fantastic. But that's 40 years ago now. And so apart from that, you mentioned the transformation of the museums, which
are many and very good.
Yes, many of them, and quite good, yes, it's true, but always hidden behind the facades. Paris were ashamed of the just a piece of glass in the street. My God, oh my. So you can imagine the Sana facade, oh my God.
Well, I think Paris, after all, is worth mentioning as the city which has good examples of continuity, not only examples, but as a total urban fabric. It has more than perhaps any other European large city this quality of being recognizable wherever you are. Mm. Paris has an identity and doesn't have any problems with its self-identity, etc., as most cities seem to have. This one of the major qualities of Paris, partly due to the intervention in the time of Osman, of course, right, could be debatable at the time, but now it's turned out to be very functional spaces even in after 150 years. But I think we must ask ourselves, why does this have to be a problem at all? In the master level in our School of Architecture, where we both teach, the students choose between studios, and one of the studios is called Contextual Space, is the studio that deals with historical architecture and urbanism. But the name implies that architecture normally is non-contextual, of course.
Exactly.
And the identity of architecture is to be contextual. And I mean, cities through history have been changing gradually, added to, they have been slowly transforming, but with basically preserving the qualities that were already there, of course, with some exceptions. But why is this now such a problem? Somehow architecture has lost its natural path of being reflective towards context. This is something failing in the art of architecture very generally that we need to consider, and that the Stockholm municipality needs to consider also.
Do you want to?
I'm thinking about something that Ann-Charlotte said earlier as well, that that you meant that if you make changes in an existing environment, you could do it in the contextual ways, in two ways, sort of adopting the old grammar of the architecture and then scale and things, but you could also develop a different way of a different kind of solution if you do it in a very thought through way compared to the old existing structure surrounding this building, and that is a very difficult way of doing it. You have to be very skilled to manage doing that, and that's one of the problems working with giving building permissions and new plans for the city. I'd love if I could have the state of Vermont in the United States in the 1980s adopted a law that said everything built should be beautiful. I'd love to have that some kind of power to say that in Stockholm today, because then I would be sure about this way of finding new architecture in old context in a good way.
But who is deciding?
Yeah, that's the problem. In Vermont, it was easy. It was the building committee.
Another thing that I thought of when you showed your pictures of ensembles with excellence is, of course, that if you go a long time back in history, we often deal with different buildings. There are buildings. And what we have to deal with today from the 20th century, when we have a heritage from the 20th century, is actually sites, like Hötorg City, for example, that is actually built as a whole and should maybe be considered then as one building, although it really consists of seven or more buildings. And that makes it a bit tricky, and I think that is one of the big challenges we have today. How do we deal with these ensembles? You pointed it out, but I think one should say something more about it, because I think if we deal with the last 100 years of architecture, a lot of the things that we actually are today seeing that we should preserve it is these kind of sites. And how do we do that? Because that is much more difficult to add or change within these structures than it is to do it in an ordinary block where you can actually take one building out and put another building in, because you have done so for several hundred years. I don't know, any comments on this or thoughts about it, further thoughts about it?
No, absolutely. I think it's a tricky one. For instance, with the glass and aluminium architecture of the 50s, which impartially is quite frail, it's a difficult one, but look at Konstfack from a similar period. Attempts have been made to. So I think, I do not think, like Arne said, that the difficult thing is make the new. I think it's also very. All architecture is difficult. Also the architecture of continuity is difficult, because the interesting one is not the one aping the other buildings, but the one which is creative and where you say a building which might not look like all the Stockholm buildings, but which has a sense of Stockholm something. So I think the new architecture plan which you discussed has its problems with. By saying that continuity is not so interesting, it stated that quality is the main thing, and quality is a bit like we talked about beauty. You know,
I was surprised because I was shown the School of Architecture by Denis Viard. We made a little tour, and I was very happy with his building, and I was quite shocked to hear that many people here in Stockholm would like to have it destroyed. Frankly speaking, I enjoyed the School of Architecture, and I thought
it's
very, very similar. I mean, in terms of size, scale, and the openings, and the it was very, very, very Swedish. I thought it was a very Swedish monument.
Mm-hmm. But this, of course, pinpoints what we have talked about earlier, this discrepancy between experts and what ordinary Stockholmers feel and so on. And I don't know if you have some comment on how should one deal with that?
That's very, very difficult a subject, especially for a French guy to speak about that, because we know that... most people in France have not overcome the limit of the entering the 28th century. They love music till Ravel, they love paintings till Winterhalter, and Picasso is already, you know, it's not possible. So, you know, it's very difficult. So we have to face it, such a contrast with knowing people and people who do not know. There's no solution, no possible solution. I'm very pessimistic about because we know what people like. They like to have steep-roofed houses with little windows, with shutters and things like that. That's the ambition of many, many people, to have a little kingdom, which is a French pavilion with outskirts, gardens and things like that. And you would propose them to live in Corbusier stuff at very low prices. They would refuse, absolutely. So. I don't see the. We're speaking next at the beginning of July. We'll have a conference in Paris. All of you friendly invited, of course, the 2 and the 3rd. And we have a discussion about Le Lignon, this fantastic building in Geneva, which has just been restored. But I realized, I spoke about this because I'm half Swiss in Switzerland. What do you think about Lignon? Oh, my God, you like this? This kilometers long apartment buildings and concrete of the 60s, 70s, and I felt very lonely in my days for that. So I do not think people are very keen on architecture in France. They like old stuff, they like patine, they like the supposed cities architecture has nothing to do with that. The interest for architecture in France is very, very little spread, very little, and especially the Ministry of Culture, where nothing is known about architecture.
having said that, I must protest. I think if there is a country where we can travel and see great projects where the architects were given possibilities, it's France.
Oh,
yeah.
Well, good, good. Please, good. Give some examples.
Yeah, I mean, you mentioned the Pompidou, for
right.
example.
Right, 40 years ago. By yeah. the time Pompidou...
Yeah, but Institut Arabe.
Yes, that's
true. Another one.
Yes. Yeah.
What about the Louvre? Is a great project.
Yes.
It's a great project.
Oh, yes, that's 30 years ago now.
Yeah, but same thing in Stockholm. I mean, our best building is from 1974. So
oh, really?
Yeah.
Uh-huh. Oh, really?
House of Culture.
I do not know Stockholm. No. I'm very sorry.
About the experts and the public and their different views, I think you have to take into respect that both views change over time.
Yes.
If you look back, for example, things that were very much criticized 30 years ago,
yes.
is loved today, also by the public. And then it changes over time. And if you ask an expert, he's sad about that the public is a little bit behind. They are not up to date, sort mm-hmm. of. When they start to value something, it's already a little bit too late, because someone what would have been good to preserve is already gone. So,
yes.
But what's left is probably not so difficult to preserve when it's adopted by the public, so to speak. And that's an important lesson. I think the national, what you say, national office for the historic inheritance, the Riksantikvarieämbetet, some 20 years ago made a future study, which was very popular doing in those years. And the question was, what will people in 30 years from now love about the historic heritage? And they try to foresee what people in the future will love and try to have a policy for adopting specifically those ideas. And I think, for example, if you take a museum, the National Nordic Museum, they have the same kind of question. They can't preserve anything. They preserve genes, they preserve, they store things that mm-hmm. they think would be valuable to have in the future for a museum, but they have to make choices all the time. And it's about making choices at the same time, this. And somewhere in between what the experts say and the public ideas, that's where you should be, I think.
Mm. Let's be a bit more optimistic. Well, in L'Aquila, for example, there is problem with preservation of the architecture of the Novecento, I mean the old 20th architecture, because they know that it's going to take benefit of the situation to ruin everything as possible, because they hate that, and especially the architecture of the 50s, 60s. They have wonderful, they have sportive equipments, and even dating back to the fascist period. Well, this might be a bit better appreciated because of... No. I'm not going to say anything. I see you smile, so I wasn't going to add horrible things. But the architecture of the 60s and 70s will disappear totally because it's been damaged, and so they will insist on the fact. But I like very much your point of view, which makes me a bit more optimistic about the idea that, after all, little by little...
In the beginning, I promised that the audience would have possibility also to put some questions, and the time is flying away, so I would give you the opportunity now to put a few questions before we try. I don't think we can summarize this, but we'll try anyhow to finish this seminar. But are there any questions, any reflections you want to put to any of our distinguished guests, or you want to share with us anyhow?
I would like to ask you about Le Grand Paris, the Sarkozy project of Le Grand Paris. What happened to that?
It's very difficult. I do not. I wouldn't possibly give you an answer. I think the idea, well, it induces an enlargement of the scale of appreciation of many, many things. At the moment, it seems the Grand Paris is just a question of means of transportation with new tracks and tubes. It doesn't... And a perspective, the idea of considering not only Paris within the walls, but with an enormous quantity of outskirts, that's very probably is essential. Because in every city, I heard in Stockholm, of course, to start with, at L'Aquila, of course, that was the first reaction since the center was destroyed to think about the large. But I'm not an expert. And it's a shame. And it's a real shame, because Commission de Paris thinks only within the walls, and it's just pointless to think about preservation unless considering because Paris lives with 10 million people, whereas the city center is just 2.5, so it's pointless to think the way it is. As many people, like in Rome, the people from Trastevere do not know the other bank. Many people in Paris, I have to admit, I never cross the walls unless by plane.
Any other questions? Yes, please.
Sorry. Yes. Hi, Cristal.
Yes, you have been discussing the preservation and the preservation angle, but it's also the needs of the future. Stockholm is growing quite at fast, very fastly, and there's a great need to harbor a growing number of people. So, don't you think we have to focus on the needs of the future? not anyone. You have mentioned any people and any individuals in this presentation, but the town, is it a building? Is it city at the building, or is it its people, its inhabitants? That's a question.
I think it's a very relevant question, and I also would like to comment on this idea. When you judge existing building and its qualities, I think there's one kind of knowledge that you need to have. But when it's about producing new environments, I think sometimes it's hard to think that we have all the answers. There are many places and situations all over the world which are designed just by totally informal situations, like vernacular architects of old fishing communities and so on. And also in a rapid growing Stockholm, I think there is, and it's difficult to find a system where you would have that kind of quality control of everything that is being built. So maybe like in the US, you have the Great American Grid, that is the only kind of legal thing that makes, that is a heritage. And then what's happening, it's a much more liberal way of planning, but it's also perhaps discusses what is heritage. I think it's very relevant, and maybe it's important to think we have such a big part now of Stockholm built from the mid-60s to the mid-70s, which we all are aware of. And another interesting example from Paris, I think, contemporary one, is the balcony addition from La Carton-Vassal, where they looked at the existing structure and what the qualities were there, and saying that using the structure, making the apartments bigger, I mean, it's a very simple tactic, but it's an example of a way to think about that, these areas that I think is very good.
Oh yes.
And I think you need to attack the existing in different ways, depending on where you are working. So then we need not one expertise, but many different solutions.
Anyone else? Otherwise, I think we have to wrap this up. And what we of course can say that we have raised a question today: can we preserve the heritage and face the needs of the future? And I would say that, well, I think we can, but we have to continue discussing how we are going to do that, and not forgetting the people that actually consist the cities. Thank you very much for attending this seminar. Thank you.